Allah protect him and give him tawfiq to do more. He's a promoter of harmony and coexistence. He is an inspiration to the young and old, Muslim and non-Muslim. And alhamdulillah, for those of you who made the effort to come early, we put the Shaykh on early, and inshallah he'll be speaking later on in the day as well. So this is a reward, inshallah, jazakallah, for all of you for making the effort to come early. And his topic is, never feel despair in His mercy again. Never feel despair in His mercy again. So without further ado, I'd like to invite up our guest, jazakallah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. MashaAllah, that was actually one of the best that I've had. MashaAllah. Barakallahu feekum. Bismillahi wa alhamdulillahi wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon all conditions. We thank Him for everything that He has bestowed upon us. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah bless them all and bless every one of you. May Allah bless your offspring, those to come up to the end. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you the offspring. And may Allah make them the coolness of your eyes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us all steadfast. My beloved brothers and sisters here in this beautiful city of Birmingham. Firstly, we all know that as submitters unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we would definitely know who Allah is. We know that He is the creator, the nourisher, the cherisher, the sustainer, the provider, the protector, the curer, the one in whose hands lies absolute control of every aspect of existence. We know that because the term Rabbun is declared right at the beginning of the Quran in Surah Al-Fatiha, the opening surah, the opening chapter of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah, Rabbul Alameen. Some of us just say, Lord of the worlds. Have you heard that? Lord of the worlds. It's not wrong, but it's only a portion of the meaning. Rabbun, made up of three letters of the Arabic language. Ra, Ba, and Ba. Rabbun. It actually refers to the one who made you, the one who created you. Whoever he is called Rabbun. The one who made you, who nourishes, cherishes, provides, takes care of, etc., etc. All the aspects of existence in his control. That is Rabbun. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, we also need to know that, you know, when you're young and you're born into a Muslim home, you're actually very fortunate. But sometimes we take it for granted, and this is why the reverts into Islam tend to be slightly stronger than the born Muslims. Sometimes the born Muslims have contaminated their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a culture that sometimes happens to contradict this faith. Culture is a good thing. When you say this person is very cultured, what do you mean? You mean they have high morals and values. You mean that they are pleasant. They know the do's and don'ts. They know how to treat and talk to people, etc. But sometimes when culture contradicts the deen, you've got to throw it out. There's a lot of racism that comes because every single tribe thinks it is better than the other. You might think you're not racist, but if you search deep down, you might find a slightly different answer. Because you think you're better, your family is better, your people are better, those around you are better. That's racism. That's tribalism sometimes. Do you know that? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. An-nasu sawasiya ka asnanil mishk. There is a saying that goes like this. People are equal, like the teeth of a comb. Like the teeth of a comb. Now, my brothers and sisters, why did I start this way? Because when we are young and we are in a Muslim home, we are told Fulfill your salah. You know, I used to say perform, but then I realized salah is not a performance. Salah is actually a fulfillment of a great act of worship. I still sometimes would probably say perform salah, but you know what we mean. I think a more appropriate term is fulfill salah. Fulfill it, because it's a fulfillment. So, if we take a look at it, we've been instructed, and sadly, a lot of us, the generation of our parents, they just told us, if you don't, you will be punished. You will be punished. And this is why when we heard, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu ittaqullah, we always translated it as, oh you who believe. Say it. Fear Allah. That was the translation of it. That's a very simple translation that sometimes does not really explain the term taqwa. Taqwa is not exactly translated in one English word, fear Allah. It is more to do with the consciousness of Allah based on the love that you have for Him that will result in you not wanting to go against His command because you love Him so much. That's what it is. When we say taqwa, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani says, and I've said this so many times, أَن تَجْعَلَ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ عَذَابِ اللَّهِ وِقَايَةً. Taqwa is to create a barrier, because in the simple Arabic language, وِقَايَةٌ means a barrier. So taqwa is to create a barrier between you and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do I fear? I fear the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By doing what? I fear it. Or I create a barrier between myself and the punishment of Allah, the displeasure of Allah, by following the commands and instructions and abstaining from the prohibitions as best as I can. So this is where the term taqwa comes in. But we were taught, fear Allah, be scared of Allah. Ooh, I'm so scared. Now I'm going to read salah because I fear Allah. It worked with some of us, mashallah. But I promise you, there are some, it doesn't work with them. They become so fearful that they think that they are going to be burning in the fire forever and ever, yet they are Muslimin. Look at the magicians at the time of the Prophet Moses, may peace be upon him, Musa alayhi salam. They engaged in one prostration, and Allah loved it so much, Allah says, I've forgiven them as a result. They were executed thereafter by the Pharaoh. But how many prostrations did they engage in? How many times did they say, Allah is our Lord? Once! Allah forgave them. How many times do you and I prostrate for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I've lost count, alhamdulillah. If Allah accepts one of those, trust me, your place in paradise inshallah will be there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it such that when we do a good deed, we don't lose it by reneging thereafter or by following it up with bad. Rather, the hadith says, and this is important for us to make a note of, أَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. When you do a bad deed, follow it up with a good deed so that it will wipe out the bad deed. That's what we are taught. If you do a bad deed, follow it up with a good deed so that the bad deed is wiped out by your good deed. Imagine, that's the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here we're talking of minor sins, sins that sometimes we perhaps don't even know we've committed, we take them for granted. Do a good deed. And then the hadith says, خَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. Treat people, or your conduct with people should be the best. Khuluq, meaning your character, the way you treat people, the way you relate to your fellow human beings, must be the best. Because that is how you earn Jannah. When the Prophet ﷺ was asked about paradise, he was asked a simple question. What are the qualities of those who will be in paradise? We want to know the main features, the main qualities, so that we can also work towards it. He says two things, taqwallahi wa husnul khuluqi, the consciousness of Allah and good character and conduct. Why those two? Have you ever asked yourself? Very simple. The first one is your relationship with your maker. The second one is your relationship with the rest of the creatures of the same maker. Allahu Akbar. Did you hear that? The first one is your relationship with your maker. Powerful. I'm conscious of Allah. The second one is your relationship with the rest of the creatures of the same maker. How He made you, He made them. How you have a right to exist, they have a right to exist. How you have this right and that right, they have similar rights. Do you fulfill their rights? Something very interesting. So, as we grew into the next generations, we found that instilling hope was primary. It became the driving factor. The world is full of gloom. The world is full of problems, depression. People are struggling, even financially. In the rich countries, people are struggling. You know, you might think, oh, I live in Britain, so wow, the people of the rest of the world think the guys who live in Britain, they're so lucky, they're so fortunate, not realizing that a lot of the people are paying loans. They're working very, very hard. They work morning to evening, 5-6 days a week. They don't get to see their children as much as they'd love to, and so on. Hard work. So life is a struggle. In the midst of that struggle, when I think about Allah, I must have positive thoughts. Everything is negative enough, but by Allah, He loves me. He really loves me, and He loves me so much, He made me, He guided me, and He's given me so much of hope that He calls Himself Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, most merciful. In a special way, or in a common way, and most merciful in a special way. He calls Himself the most beneficent, the most merciful. Allah. Never in the Quran do you find the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala where He says He's going to punish you, if you get what I mean. It's always about mercy, about love, about compassion. And yes, He does say retribution and just and so on, because justice does definitely, or justice is a quality of those who are great. So if those who are great, justice would be a good quality, then Allah's quality is far above all of those. Subhanallah, that is Allah. He's the just, but together with that justice, He is most merciful. He forgives. When you know you can do something about someone who's actually done something wrong to you, but you still forgive them, what happens? It means you are truly merciful. I know I can penalize you, I can punish you. Don't worry, it's okay. You know, it's fine. I don't want to continue in this way. I want to forgive you, subhanAllah. And I want you to know that Allah is more merciful upon us than anyone else can be towards us. Remember that. It's in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the suckling mother, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks, do you think that this lady can actually cast her child into the fire? And they said, it's impossible. She will never do that. Well, I want you to know that Allah is much more merciful upon us than this woman can ever be upon that particular child. So we need to worship Allah, loving Allah. Taqwallahi, there needs to be an element of the love of Allah such that a barrier is created between me and the displeasure of Allah. I want to worship Allah because of taqwa, because I love Allah. I'm so conscious of His love for me. That's why I want to worship Him. I love Him so much. He takes care of me. He's given me my eyes and my nose, the faculty of hearing and all other faculties, subhanAllah. He's granted me the ability to be here this morning or to listen to this later on, subhanAllah. He loves me, surely He does. And don't think that the difficulties that are placed in your life are actually part of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are reminders from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indeed. But if they result in you becoming closer to Allah, they were a mercy of Allah. Some of us have never called out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until we fall ill and sick, or we have a financial problem or a marital problem or some form of an issue, and then we turn to Allah and we say, was this a punishment? Well, if you turned to Allah as a result, it was actually the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was actually Allah's gift upon you. So we all make mistakes. We do, because we're human beings. Every time we hear, you know what, I'm a human. Never use the fact that you're human to intentionally perpetrate a crime. I'm human, you know, so I'm going to the club tonight. Come on, take it easy. I'm a human being, so I'm going to drink a little bit. Take it easy. Don't use that as an excuse to sin. But if you have sinned out of human nature, because your nafs or your soul has driven you towards that, seek Allah's forgiveness. I tell you why. Imagine if your little child, whom you love the most, has done something wrong and comes to you and says, I'm sorry, please forgive me. What will happen? Don't worry, my son, it's fine, it's okay. Subhanallah. Don't worry, that's okay. And they do it again, what will you do? It's okay, you're my son. And they look at you.